And for the last 11 years, he has been managing director of Roman. And his topic is the effect of pandemic on ways of education are to stay longer for good. Very much looking forward to your presentation, Mr. Gupta.
Thank you very much. It's indeed a pleasure and a privilege to be part of this interesting colloquium, which has a long history as part of India Week celebrations in Hamburg. Also, it's a great privilege to have these interesting discussions, particularly post-COVID, and most of the insights have been quite eye-opening. The topic that I'm going to address is about the effects of pandemic on the education and how are we going to take a look at them and then to see which of those effects are going to stay here. So COVID-19 has resulted in schools shut all across the world. More than 1.2 billion children in 186 countries were affected by the school closures due to the pandemic. There were lockdowns. Countries were initially hesitant, but then one by one, countries had to take this hard decision in terms of keeping children at home. Keeping the children at home has an effect on also the working parents. They cannot go to the offices. So there was a kind of a cyclic effects, ripple effects on particularly this education sector. And then even before COVID, there was already a high growth and adoption in education technologies, edutech, as we call them. Just like a blessing in disguise, this was a kind of a quick alternative that was available for the schools to see that the education is not hampered, but somehow continued. And that has shown a tremendous growth and a positive impact on the edutech sector, particularly the online education. The overall market for online education projected to $350 billion by 2025. In 2019, it was $18.66 billion. That's a tremendous positive projection. While this appears to be like a boom and also a kind of a solution for all the problems that the COVID has created onto the education, there are some good examples like Byju's in India has is the one of the highest valued edutech company. It was started in 2011 in Bangalore as a edutech company. And with tremendous investments flowing in, this company is doing exceptionally well in these times. And then Alibaba's distance learning solution, DingTalk, deployed more than 100,000 new cloud services in just 2 hours at one point in time during the COVID. So there has been a tremendous outpour of technologies. In fact, the platform that we are using today for this conference, the Zoom, has seen tremendous uprise and quick adaptation by many schools and educational organizations of these kind of technologies, Microsoft Teams, there are many to name, but without getting into the details, what I like to present at this point is that as a positive uprise of these technological solutions has been a remarkable step during the COVID. Now, is that all good, nice, positive story, or are there any problems as well? Yes, of course, there are challenges. While the required technologies were available, there are, however, challenges faced by the education providers and the students. The problems are manifold. I would like to cover a few of them. First problem is with the technology in terms of internet bandwidth and the devices. So mobile phones, tablets, laptops were widely used, and particularly in countries like India, we have more than two or three mobile phones per household, and they were all brought into effect during this pandemic. So the abundant availability of gadgets was more or less a kind of a positive solution. However, in remote and less privileged homes, this was a challenge. In school, we do have a wide, range of students from middle, upper middle, lower middle, and different backgrounds, economic backgrounds. And so for those in the lower economic backgrounds, availability of technology was a problem. And in some cases, the bandwidth was a problem. In big cities, there was okay, somewhat availability of the bandwidth was there. But then when it comes to the rural and the availability of the towers was again a problem. And then access to technology, not all schools were equipped with the required basic technology like, webcam or basic tools like a computer and connectivity to the classrooms. All of this was not available. This was quickly solved with some infuse of capital by the schools. And the problem was the pandemic has hit exactly at a time when the one academic year came to an end and the other academic year was about to start. And by then governments took the step that to keep the children at home, and parents were reluctant to pay the fees for the next subsequent years. So that was a huge problem where the schools were not able to receive any fees for the next academic years. And at the same time, they were required to invest money for the technology. So that was one problem. If we keep aside these technology related problems, what are the other kind of problems? We saw engagement models as a problem. How to engage the parents, how to engage the students, children remotely gain access to the education was a problem. Overall, education model in terms of the textbooks and the method of teaching was not something which was useful or ready for applying for online. More or less the teachers were basically replacing the same classroom-based teaching methodology in front of the webcams. And they were just giving, extending the classrooms via online to the homes, which in my view is a very poor method of transfer of knowledge that has created a lot of problem, very chaotic and too much of stress on some children. They were not able to follow the lessons. And when the children were smaller in age, the problem went to the parents. Parents had to sit by them and make sure that they're able to get to these lessons. So that is the education models were not appropriate. Evaluation models. At some point in time, the monthly exams and quarterly tests and annual tests came in, and nobody had a clue how to conduct an examination. The examination that we are known about is a closed book model of examination. And how do we ask the children to close their books and attend the exam staying at home? That was a big problem. Now, in this direction, our company Glomen Group, what we have been doing is to develop an education model that fits to these kind of requirements. And we have been in this job much earlier than pandemic. Initially, our aim was to see if we are able to take the German vocational education system and extract the value of it and bring it to India. And what we quickly realized in 3 years' time is that it is impossible to copy paste the model of vocational education system from Germany to India. The underlying pillars in Germany were totally different to that of in India. So what we turned to is, okay, if we are not able to copy paste the model, is there any way that we can extract the value? And there we found some linkages between the German vocational education system and the ancient Gurukul model of education of India. And we kind of pulled some strings together and created a model. The baseline of this is Trividya, Chatushiksha, Panchamedha. Is the kind of a foundation of the education model that our company has put forth. And we are now trying to introduce this into the schools and try to see if we are able to transfer some knowledge from the source of knowledge to the aspirants. With that, I thank for this opportunity to be able to put up a broad overview of effect of pandemic on the education and a small bit that we are doing in towards meeting these challenges. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gopiprasad. Any questions to him? I think we will have time for maximum two. Professor, would you like to?
Gopiprasad, you mentioned a lot about what happened in these last 2 years. Do you have any concept what you would be doing in the near future? Because as we see, the rates are again, at least in Germany, they're again going up. Are there any lessons learned from there? What you would say from now on, this is something that we would do. I'm asking also as a teacher myself somewhere. Thank you.
Yeah. So everybody is trying their best and experimenting. What we have come up with this model that I just suggested, Trividya, is three-dimension learning, where we are making a combination of active learning, interactive learning, and collaborative learning. Meaning to say, we look at the content which has to be transferred in terms of knowledge and see from what parts of this content can be delivered through self-directed learning model. And then we look at the same content and see which part of this content can be delivered through faculty-directed learning model. And then we pull up some problems or challenges that can be given as a case studies or a problem-solving exercises and give it as a small group learning, collaborative learning model. So Trividya is where we break down the whole knowledge, the content into three parts and correspondingly develop the learning tools. And Chatushiksha is where is a hand-holding process. So whatever shortfalls that we see in the learning, in the teaching part, we get them covered in the coaching part. So we kind of have built up a mechanism where we divide the whole content into four different measurable components. So for example, if we have physics, so we kind of take away all the diagrams, take away all the formulas in one side and the definitions and descriptions onto one side, application of the formula is on the other side. So we divide all of that into four and then check where the student is facing the problem. So we only give a test, which is only the diagrams and then see how he's doing with the diagrams. Is he getting it well or problem? Only formulas, is he good in memorizing and reproducing them? Application of the formula. So we give a case and is he able to apply it? Is he finding a difficulty in that part? So this is a kind of a little bit of four dimension coaching model that we have brought in. And the last but not least is the Pancha Medha, which is five component intellect based on the five senses of the body, particularly for the primary level education. It is all about how much of image memory, you know, Drishya Medha, Gandha Medha, Shabda Medha. So each of those intellect, how much of it is there? So if I ask you to close your eyes and I say cat, are you getting an image of a cat in your mind? Meaning to say you have image memory about certain components and we apply certain exercises. So we did this experiment in a school where we asked the children to go one round of around the school compound and they come back and then we start asking questions. Okay, in the first 100 meters, what did you see? And they are clueless. The second 100 meters, what did you see? One or two might say. And then we send them again, now second time, and now they are more attentive. And so we kind of evaluate these processes. So we are still working on these models and we are experimenting with few schools in India. We're quite thankful to those schools for having given us the opportunity to experiment with the children. And I'm sure in coming days, our model will be getting more opportunity. And I'm glad to say that the first topic that we dealt with applying this model is Bhagavad Gita. So we took, how can we transfer the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita through our model and give it as a co-curricular activity to the schools? The idea behind was if we are successful in transferring the knowledge of highly philosophical documents such as Bhagavad Gita, we are fairly confident that we can deal with any other subject. Thank you.
Thank you. That was a very nice explanation. I would have asked you the same question as well.